IT governance model, as elegant as Miss America. So let's go take a delve into four key aspects of the IT decision making in companies.
Ah yes, the Weill, Ross IT governance model. Let's talk a little bit more about what it's all about. You see, every enterprise engages in IT decision making, but each differs considerably in how thoughtfully it defines accountability and how rigorously it formalizes and communicates decision making. When senior managers take the time to design, implement, and communicate IT governance processes, companies get more value through IT. Weill, Ross IT governance model. Now that you kind of have an introduction into what we're delving into, let's talk about the major decisions that go on in IT, IT decision making, major decision domains specifically. IT principles comprise high-level decisions about strategic role of IT in a business. IT architecture includes an integrated set of technical choices that guide the organization in satisfying business needs. IT infrastructure consists of the centrally coordinated shared IT services that provide the foundation for the enterprise IT capability and were typically created before precise usage needs were known. Next, we have business application. Needs are the business requirements for purchased or internally developed IT applications. Last, prioritization and investment decisions determine how much and where to invest in IT. Now, as we discuss IT decisions, we have to talk about the different approaches and systems that different enterprises utilize when approaching the IT decision making involved in a corporation, small business, and so forth. One being business monarchy, another being IT monarchy, another system called federal system, and another IT duopoly, fifthly, feudal system, and another lastly, would be anarchy. First, now let's discuss business monarchy. Business monarchy is an IT decision-making process that's utilized in different enterprises where it's the most centralized approach out of the ones previously listed. A senior business executive or a group of senior executives, sometimes including the CIO, makes all the IT-related decisions for the enterprise. The second one that I spoke about is IT monarchy. Those decisions are made by an individual IT executive or a group of IT executives. In a federal system, the third one I spoke of, the C-level executive and business representatives of all the operating groups collaborate with the IT department. This is equivalent to the central government and the states working together. Continuing on with government governance archetypes, the fourth one would be IT duopoly that some enterprises utilize. A two-party decision-making approach that involves IT executives and a group of business leaders representing the operating units. The fifth one is a feudal system approach. Business unit or process leaders make separate decisions on the basis of the unit or process needs. And finally, the most decentralized system that I could think of would have to be the anarchy approach, in which each individual user or small group pursues his or her own IT agenda. That has to be hectic. For the next aspect of the Weill, Ross IT governance model, let's bring in world-renowned researcher from Bauer, Nguyen, to discuss governance mechanisms that are undertaken in enterprises for IT decision-making.
Thank you, world-renowned researcher Malcolm West. As for governance mechanisms, Once the types of mechanisms and the archetypes for making those decisions are mapped out, a company must design and implement a coordinated set of governance mechanisms that managers will work with on a daily basis. Enterprises generally design three kinds of governance mechanisms. The first one is decision-making structures, and then alignment processes, and lastly, formal communications. Now, let's go more into detail about decision-making structures. The most visible IT governance mechanism are the organizational committees and the roles that locate decision-making responsibilities according to intended archetypes. Different archetypes rely on different decision-making structures. Anarchies require no decision-making structures at all. Feudal arrangements rely on local decision-making structures. But monarchy, federal, or duopoly arrangements demand decision-making structures with the representation and authority to produce enterprise-wide synergies. Now, continuing on with decision-making structures, here are seven examples. Steering committee, IT policy boards, architecture committees, business unit CIO, IT council at low level, process organization, and business/IT relationship manager. Lastly, while we're still on the topic of IT governance mechanisms, we must include the communications approach and go into more detail about it. A huge barrier to effective IT governance is lack of understanding about how decisions are made, what processes are being implemented, and what the desired outcomes are. Management can communicate governance processes in a variety of ways. First is general announcements. Second is the institution of formal committees. Third, regular communication from the office of CIO or the office of IT governance. And fourth, one-on-one sessions. Fifth, working with the non-conformists. And lastly, intranets. More communication generally means more effective governance.
Great to see you back again. Now, allow us to come full circle after I've taken you through the intricacies of the Weill and Ross IT governance model. As they state, it is focused on, I quote, the specifying the decision rights and accountability framework to encourage desirable behavior in the use of IT. Their research shows that firms with explicit IT governance systems have twice the profit of firms with poor governance. Given the same strategic objectives, just as corporate governance systems aim to ensure quality decisions about corporate assets, the authors show companies need IT governance systems to ensure that IT investments are made wisely and effectively. And there you have it, Weill and Ross IT governance model.